AquarianRadio.com.
Aloha, this is Enki. You know me as Aquarius, and this is our age, the Satayuga. Time to celebrate with us. We have programs on all chakra tantra, love styles and relationship choices, counseling strategies and techniques that you can use at home. We have extraterrestrial radio where we deal with alienology, paranormal people, and we have an experiencers network. We have a section called Ancient Aliens, and the programs therein are Enki Speaks, Nimma, the Mother of Humanity, has her program, and we revise ancient anthropology. And most important of all, we have peace paradigms. Because this is the age of peace, harmony and understanding, sympathy and trust abounding. No more falsehoods or derisions, golden living dreams of visions, mystic crystal revelations, and the mind's true liberation.
This is Enki.
It is I who 300,000 years ago created your race, and 200,000 years ago, it was a lot of fun, made it even better with some of the pretty girls. And it is I who saved you from the flood, and it is I and my beloved Nimma and my son Ningxiga Thoth who are here to help you overcome my runaway son Marduk or Allah, my brother Enlil or Yahweh. And free yourself from all the supposed gods and recognize your own great potential. You have much to teach us. And we, Anunnaki, those of us from Nibiru, welcome full partnership.
And here are your hosts, Janet and Dr. Sasha Lesson.
Aloha and welcome to Aquarian Radio. Today's show is Enki Speaks. The title of today's show is Galzu Gives Enki and Noah Ark Plans, the plans for the Ark. Today is January 18th, 2013, and I am your host, Janet Kirilesson, and we're broadcasting live from Maui, Hawaii, with my co-host and beloved husband, Dr. Sasha Lesson. And do you want to start with a little bit?
Yeah, I'd love to. So we've been tracing the history of the settlers, the gold miners from the planet Nibiru who came to Earth starting 450,000 years ago and established this huge mining complex in the south of Africa. And they, for working the mines, they used hybrids. Their genes, these are great big tall Homo sapiens, and the genes of some local hominid named Homo erectus that was here, and they, these people from Nibiru kept mating with the prettiest of these hybrids, and more and more and more and more, and we found out in the last time is that the chief foreman that Enki, their chief scientist, was employing a guy named Lumak, had a pretty wife named Batnash, and Enki seduced her, and they had the baby that our Bible knows calls Noah. Of course, that was his ancient name was Siasudra, and Enki and his sister Nimma, the mother of humanity, really gave everything to this child, to Siasudra, and he was the most educated person on Earth besides the Anunnaki. He read all of the works of Adapa, who'd spent his whole life compiling wisdom, and so this was a very, very learned man. And he had three sons about the time of today's episode. Today's episode takes place about 13,000 years ago. Earth has entered an ice age, things have gotten really bad, then there's global warming, and it seems like the Antarctic ice sheet is about to slip into the South Sea. Well, the commander of the expedition, a guy named Enlil, later called Yahweh, forbade any of the Nibirans to tell any of the Earthlings, that's what they called us, about the coming flood, because they knew when the Antarctic ice sheet slipped into the South Sea, it would make this gigantic wave and, for months and bury everything, and only people in the highest mountains would survive. And one of the things that happened, we saw last episode, they had, the king of Nibiru, Anu, had said, okay, well, we got enough gold to turn into white powder of monoatomic gold. We got it all from Earth and processed it in our atmospheres, doing well. And so, you know, the flood's coming. I want everybody to come home. And he sent a whole bunch of rocket ships to take all the Nibirans home. There was about 900 of them or so. And one of the rocket ships had in it this white-haired guy named Galzu, which means great knower, who said he was the representative of the king, and that his words were the king's words. And he, what he did is he told Enki, the chief scientist, Nimma, the chief medical officer, and their kids, look, you can't go back to Nibiru because you've been on Earth too long, and you'll die if you stay if you come back to Nibiru. So you got to stay here. So why don't you orbit the planet? And the commanders said, okay, Nannar, that's his oldest son on Earth, will go to the moon. Others of us will circle the Earth and see what happens when this flood happens, and then we'll return to Earth. And I forbid anybody from telling the Earthlings what's coming down, because they'll mob the spaceports and we won't be able to safely get off. And besides that, I want them all to die. They're an illegal race. They shouldn't have been created in the first place. And we're in trouble with the Federation for having a slave race. So just let them all drown. And I forbid any of you to say anything about this. And so this is where we left off last time. So now we're going to talk about what happens and it next. And you need to, first we're going to read our summary, tell you what, sort of summarize what's happening in ordinary English, and then we will read the actual words of Enki as Zechariah translated them and put them into the lost book of Enki. So all this is about 13,000 years ago. We'll start with Janet.
Enki dreamed, Galzu spoke, into your hands fate take, for the earthlings the earth inherit. Summon your son, Zeusudra, without breaking the oath. They had an oath to swear not to tell the earthlings. To him, the coming calamity reveal. A boat that the watery avalanche can withstand, a submersible one, to build him tell, the likes of which on his tablet to you I am showing. Let him in it save himself and his kinfolk, and the seed of all that is useful, be it plant or animal, also take. That is the will of the creator of all.
Enki woke. He pondered his dream. He stepped out of bed, and he kicked an actual physical tablet. There it was, right next to his bed. The tablet showed how to build a submersible craft, one in which Zeusudra and his whole community of followers could ride out the delusion. Enki searched his home and grounds for Galzu when he woke up. He thought, well, maybe the guy, you know, put this tablet there. He got out of bed and he kicked it. But nobody except Enki in the dream had even seen Galzu at Enki's place. Well, Sitchin terms the appearance of this tablet, this physical object, after Enki's dream encounter with Galzu, to be the representative of a higher power, a Twilight Zone miracle.
That night, into the reed hut where Zeusudra was sleeping, Enki stealthily went. The oath not breaking, the Lord Enki, not to Zeusudra, but to the hut's wall, the computer bank, spoke from behind the reed wall. When Zeusudra by the words awakened to him, Enki said, "Reed hut, a calamitous storm will sweep. The destruction of mankind it will be. This is the decision of the assembly by Enlil convened. Abandon thy house, Yasudra, and build a boat. Its design and measurements on a tablet, a boat guide, Ninigal, to you shall come. To a safe haven the boat guide will navigate you. By you shall the seed of civilized man survive. Not to you, Yasudra, have I spoken, but to the reed wall did I speak.
Ninigal, of course, is a son of Enki and Damkina. Yasudra and his community, and they're in Basara, Enki's place there, they built the ark. And if you look at our website, www.enkispeaks.com, we have all these pictures of the construction of the ark and all kinds of really great illustrations. Yasudra was told by Enki, and he did this, he explained to Commander Enlil that he was just building this ark so that he could sail his community down to Enki's palace in Southeast Africa, since it was Enki that he was devoted to. And so Enlil didn't care. He thought everybody was going to drown anyway. Now, Enlil did not know that Yasudra was Enki's son, but he let the construction continue. Let Enki's followers leave Mesopotamia, sail to Africa, and there they'll die in the flood to come, thought Commander Enlil.
Enki prepared. Before the wave hit, he sent Ninigal with boxes to Yasudra. The boxes held DNA, sperm, and ova, the life essence and life legs of living creatures it contains, by the Lord Enki and Nimma collected, from the wrath of Enlil to be hidden, to life resurrected if earth be willing. Ningishida prepared too. He inscribed ancient wisdom on two great pillars and hid sacred objects and scrolls inside them.
So 13,000 years ago, quote, in the White Land, at the Earth's bottom, off its foundation, the Antarctic ice sheet slipped. By Nibiru's net force, gravity, it was pulled into the South Sea, Indian Ocean. A tidal wave arose, spreading northward. The tidal wave, several hundred meters high, moved northward from Antarctica at 500 kilometers per hour. Like a giant circle, it whipped around the world. It destroyed all lands lower than 2,000 meters above sea level.
The boat of Yasudra, the tidal wave from its moorings lifted. Then when the waves closed over the ark, though completely submerged, not a drop of water into it did enter. For 40 days, waves and storms swept earth, drowning everything on the planet except those on the mountaintops and in Yasudra's boat.
Okay, now we're going to read from the Book of Enki, the actual poetry of this great scientist's words. We begin with Janet.
This is from the 10th tablet of the Lost Book of Enki. In Sippar, all the Anunnaki gathered. The day of the deluge they awaited. It was at that time, as the tension of awaiting was mounting, that the Lord Enki, asleep in his quarters, had a dream vision. In the dream vision there appeared the image of a man, bright and shining like the heavens. And as the man Enki approached, Enki saw that the white-haired Galzu he was. In his right hand, an engraver's stylus he was holding, and in his left hand, a tablet of lapis lazuli, shining smooth, he held. And as he approached near enough by Enki's bed to stand, Galzu spoke up and said, "Unwarranted your accusations against Enlil were, for only the truth he spoke, and the decision that as Enlil's decision will be known, not he, but destiny decreed. Now into your hands, fate take, for the earthlings the earth will inherit. Summon your son Yasudra, without breaking the oath to him, the coming calamity reveal. A boat that the watery avalanche can withstand, a submersible one, to build him tell. The likes of which on this tablet to you I am showing. Let him in it save himself and his kinfolk, and the seed of all that is useful, be it plant or animal, also take. That is the will of the Creator of all. engulfs you in dream vision with the stylus on the tablet an image drew, and place the engraved tablet by the side of Enki's bed.
So it's worth noting that the Anunnaki believe in and have reference to again and again to the creator of all, and that Enki, and you'll see all of the leaders eventually believe that Galzu was a representative of the federation of this higher order of the creator of all, himself or herself.
Itself.
Okay. So after the image faded, the dream vision ended, and Enki, with a shudder, awoke. In his bed, Enki for a while lying remained, with wonder the dream vision he pondered. Off his bed then he stepped, and there was the tablet. What, in a mere dream vision he had seen, now by his bedside, materially was. A design of curiously shaped boat upon the tablet he saw. By the tablet's edge, measuring markings there were, measuring markings. The boat's measures were indicated. Now, none to Galzu was able to find. Enki's looking all over. Galzu, they said, to Nibiru, went back long time ago. Well, that night, to the reed hut where Ziasutra was sleeping, Enki went stealthily. Enki, not to Ziasutra, but to the wall, spoke. He said, "Reed hut, to my instructions heed. Storm of all on all the habitations, a storm will sweep. Destruction of mankind in its offering it will be. The final ruling of the assembly by Enlil convened says, abandon your house, build a boat, spurn possessions, save the life." This is what I'm telling you. No matter what was told you by the council, I'm telling you, abandon your house, build a boat, spurn possessions, save your lives. The boat that you must build, its design and measurement on a tablet are shown. By the reed hut's wall, the tablet, I shall leave. The boat shall be roofed throughout. The sun from the inside must not be seen. Use pitch strong and tight. Let the boat be one that can turn and tumble. In 7 days, build the boat. Into it, your family and kinfolk gather. In the boat, food and water for drinking heap up. Household animals also bring. On the appointed day, a signal to you will be given. A boat guide who knows the waters, by me appointed, to you that day will come. Of course, that's Ninigal. The boat you must enter. Its hatch tightly close you must. An overwhelming deluge coming from the south, lands and life shall devastate. Your boat from its moorings it shall lift, the boat it shall turn and tumble, but to a safe haven the boat guide will navigate you. By you shall the seed of civilized mankind survive. And not to you, Ziasutra, have I spoken. To the reed wall did I speak, Enki said. By Enlil's decision, by an oath upheld, am I bound. To that all the Anunnaki swore. If my face you shall see, surely like all the other earthlings you'll die. So I'm now just talking to the reed hut, but you can listen. The purpose of the boat, a secret of the Anunnaki, with you must remain. Don't tell them what it's for. When the townspeople inquire, say, the Lord Enlil to my Lord Enki has grown angry, and to Enki's abode in Abzu, Africa, I am sailing.
I just want to comment on that. It seems that this is more of a submersible. We have the biblical description of it was three stories high and so many cubits. But this one is more like a submersible. It shall be roofed throughout. The sun from the inside must not be seen, and the tack must be strong so that it can pitch and survive the waterly avalanche.
So this seems like a more logical construct, you know, point of construction.
Yeah, it was capable of sailing once it emerged, but first it was underneath the water and tumbling all around.
Right. So, okay, back to reading. Once again, is the 10th tablet of the Lost Book of Enki. For a while, a silence followed. Ziusudra from behind the reed wall came. A tablet of lapis lazuli in the moonlight shining, he saw and picked up. The image of a boat upon it was drawn, notches its measurements gave. Wisest of civilized men was Ziusudra. What he had heard, he understood. In the morning to the townspeople, he so announced, "The Lord Enlil, with the Lord Enki, my master, angry has been. On that account to me, the Lord Enlil is hostile. In this city I no longer reside can, nor in the Eden my foot any more set. To the Abzu, the Lord Enki's domain, I will there a sailing go. In a boat that must quickly be built, I will away from here depart. Thereby the Lord Enlil's anger will subside, hardships will end. Upon you the Lord Enlil abundance henceforth will shower." The morning was not yet gone when the people about Ziusudra gathered. To speedily for him the boat build, they each other encouraged. Timbers of boat wood the elders were hauling, the little ones bitumen from the marshes carried.
Bitumen. And
bitumen. Bitumen. You say bitumen. Potato, potato. As woodworkers the planks together hammered, Ziusudra in a cauldron, the bitumen melted. With bitumen, the boat he waterproofed inside and out. As in the drawing upon the tablet, the boat by the fifth day was completed. Eager to see Ziusudra depart, the townspeople to the boat food and water brought. From their own mouths sustenance they took to appease Enlil. They were in a hurry. Four-legged animals into the boat were also driven. Birds from the field by themselves flew in. Into the boat Ziusudra, his spouse and sons, made embark. Their wives and children also came. Any who to the abode of the Lord Enki wished to go, let them too aboard come. So did Ziusudra to the gathered people announce. Envisioning Enlil's abundance, only some of the craftsmen the call heeded. On the sixth day, Ninigal, the lord of the waters, of the great waters, to the boat came. Okay. Sorry.
So Ninigal was a son of Enki. He was going to be the navigator. A box of cedar wood in his hands he held. By his side in the boat, he kept it. The life essences and life eggs of living creatures this cedar wood box contains. This is what the Lord Enki and Nimmah collected. From the wrath of Enlil to be hidden, to life resurrect, if earth be willing. So did Ninigal to Ziusudra explain. Thus were all beasts by their twos in the boat in the boat hidden. In other words, he had the sperms and eggs, not necessarily two giraffes and two elephants and two rhinos and so forth. Now Ninigal and Ziusudra in the boat, the arrival of the seventh day awaited. In the 120th Shar, rotation of Nibiru around through the inner solar system, was the deluge awaited. In the 10th Shar, in the life age of Zarathustra, was the deluge forthcoming. In the station of the constellation of the Lion was the avalanche looming, that's to the south. Now this is the account of the deluge that over Earth swept, how the Anunnaki escaped, how Ziusudra survived. Before the calamity struck in the heavens, Nibiru, as a glowing star, was seen. Then there was darkness in daytime, and at night the moon was as though by a monster swallowed. Earth began to shake by a net force before unknown it was agitated. In the glow of dawn, a black cloud arose on the horizon. The morning's light to darkness changed. The rolling thunder boomed. Lightnings lit the skies. Depart! Utu to the Anunnaki gave the signal. Depart! Crouched in the boats of heaven, rocket ships, the Anunnaki heavenward were lofted. In Sharubuk, 18 leagues away, the bright eruptions by Ninigal were seen. Button up the hatch, Nitigal to Zeosutra shouted. Together, the trapdoor that the hatch concealed, they pulled down. Watertight, enclosed completely, was the boat. Inside, not a drop of light, not a ray of light penetrated.
On that day, on that unforgettable day, the deluge with a roar began. In the white land, at the earth's bottom, the earth's foundations were shaking. Then with a roar to a thousand thunders equal off its foundations, the ice sheet slipped. By Nibiru's unseen net force, it was pulled away into the South Sea, crashing. One sheet of ice into another ice sheet was smashing. The white land's surface, like a broken eggshell, was crumbling. All at once a tidal wave arose. The very skies was the wall of waters reaching. A storm with ferocity never before seen at the earth's bottom began to howl. Its winds, the wall of water, were driving. The tidal wave northward was spreading. Northward was the wall of waters onrushing. The Abzu lands it was reaching. Therefrom, toward the settled lands it traveled, the Eden it overwhelmed. When the tidal wave, the wall of towers, the wall of waters, Cherubuk reached, the boat of Zeosudra, the tidal wave from its moorings lifted. Tossed it about like a watery abyss, the boat it swallowed. Though completely submerged, the boat held firm, not a drop of water into it did enter. Outside the storm's wave, the people overtook like a killing battle. No one his fellow man could see. The ground vanished. There was only water. All that once on the ground stood by the mighty waters away was swept. Before day's end, the watery wall, gathering speed, the mountains overwhelmed. In their celestial boats, the Anunnaki, the earth, were circling. Crowding the compartments against the outer walls, they crouched. What was happening upon the earth down below to see they strained. From the celestial boat in which she was, Nima, like a woman in travail, cried out, My created like drowned dragonflies in a pond the waters fill. All life by the rolling sea waves away was taken. Thus did Nima cry and moan. Inanna, who was with her, also cried and lamented. Everything down below, all that lived, has turned into clay. Thus did Nima and Inanna weep. They wept and eased their feelings. In the other celestial boats, the Anunnaki, by the sight of unbridled fury, were humbled. A power greater than theirs, they, with awe, those days witnessed. For the fruits of earth they hungered, for fermented elixir they thirsted.
The sluices of heaven opened up. Downpour from the skies upon the earth was unleashed. For 7 days the waters from above and the waters of the great below were mingled. There was all the different seas had waves that were bouncing into each other and bouncing all over. And this stuff is all over the world. The Hopi that survived in their caves on the top of the mountains, all over the world. This 13,000 year ago flood, the flood that drowned Lemuria was observed. Rains from the skies for 40 more days and nights continued. Where there were dry lands, now was a sea of water. Where mountains once to the heavens their peaks raised, their tops now, like islands, were in the waters. All that on dry lands was living in the avalanche of waters perished. Then, as in the beginning, the waters to their basins gathered. And day by day, the water level became lower. The rain stopped, and after the 40 days, Zeosutra, the boat's hatch, opened.
A bright day it was. A gentle breeze was blowing. All alone, with no other sign of life, the boat upon a vast sea was lolling. Mankind, all living things of the earth's face, were wiped out. No one except us few survived, but there is no dry land to set a foot upon. So did Zeosudra to his kinfolk say as he sat down and lamented. At that time, Ninigal, by Enki, pointed the boat toward the twin peaks of Arata, directed. A sail for her he shaped, toward the Mount of Salvation he the boat guided. Impatient, Ziusudra was, birds that were on board he released. To check for dry land, for surviving vegetation, to verify he sent them. He sent forth a swallow, he sent forth a raven, both to the boat returned. He sent forth a dove with a twig from a tree to the boat it returned. Now, Ziusudra knew that the dry land from under the waters had emerged. A few more days, and the boat by rocks was arrested. The deluge is over. At the Mount of Salvation we are, so did Ninigal to Ziusudra say. Opening the watertight hatch from the boat, Ziusudra emerged. The sky was clear. The sun was shining. A gentle wind was blowing. Hurriedly upon his spouse and children he to come out called. The Lord Enki let us praise, to him give thanks, to them Ziusudra said. With his son's stones he gathered, with them an altar he built. Then a fire and altar he lit, with aromatic light incense he made a fire. An ewe lamb, one without blemish. A ewe lamb, one without blemish for a sacrifice he selected. And upon the altar to Enki, the ewe lamb, as a sacrifice, he offered.
Okay. At that time, Enlil, from his celestial boat to Enki, words conveyed. So he's in his rocket ship, and he's wires Enki. He says, "Let us in the whirlwinds," and the helicopters, "from the celestial boats upon the peak of Arata descend." So Enlil and Enki and whirlbirds upon the peak of Arata descended. Enlil, by the whiffs of fire and roasting meat, was puzzled. The boat of Ziusudra they saw. By the altar that he had built, they landed. When Enlil the survivor saw Ninigal, Enki's son, among them, his fury no bounds had. Every earthling had to perish. He with fury shouted at Enki. With anger he lunged to kill his brother. With his bare hands he was ready. "He's no mere mortal. My son he is," Enki to Ziusudra pointing cried out. Enlil, hesitating, "You broke your oath," he shouted. "To a reed wall I spoke, not to Ziusudra," Enki said. To Enlil, the dream vision, he related about how Galzu had come to him. Ninurta and Nimma in their whirlbirds also touched down. And Ninurta and Nimma, they weren't angry. The survival of mankind, the will of the creator of all must be. So did Ninurta to his father say. Wait, Janet wants to read something.
I want to say this line, because this is Nimma. Nenma, her necklace of crystals, a gift of Anu, touched and swore. "On my oath, the annihilation of mankind shall never be repeated." Relenting, Enlil by the hand, Ziusudra and Emzara, his spouse, took and blessed them thus. "Be fruitful and multiply, and the earth replenish." Thus were the olden times ended. So this was very important to understand, that it wasn't God, it was Nimma who said, "On my oath, the annihilation of mankind shall never be repeated." So she gave us a promise that she will never let the annihilation of mankind happen again. And in future recordings, I will share what she's told me in some channelings about that promise she made to us. And then Enlil blessed Ziusudra and Emzara, his spouse, and told them to be fruitful and multiply. But we'll see later on, he gave them at least longevity. And I think that's where we end today.
Yeah.
Go ahead, just some final words, honey.
Well, just you have to understand that that's what's happening here, is that the leaders are having an extended discussion. Not only is Noah or Ziasutra the direct son of Enki with a woman, Batanash, who is a very large percentage Nibiran too, but that Enlil is convinced by his sister and his son and everybody else that started coming down, the other Anunnaki, that look, we can't leave Earth, we got to stay here, everything's ruined, we need slaves, or we're gonna have to do the work ourselves. And so Enlil went for it finally. Okay, let's rule through Noah and his three sons, and Japhet, Ham, and we'll talk about what happens about the three divisions that Enlil allowed. But the idea after the flood was, we will use our great technology, the Nibiran said, and we'll set up these people, we'll drain the waters, we'll make canals, we'll build cities, and we'll have palaces where we can keep our aircraft, and we won't have to do any work. We can just go on about the business of living here. And well, one of the things they find out is that this nearing of Nibiru to Earth not only messed up Earth with this gigantic deluge, but it also caused havoc with the shield that they had made of white powder of monoatomic gold that was supposed to protect the atmosphere of Nibiru. And this got blown away too. So now they needed more gold. They needed people to work for them, and they had to set things up. And it also ruined Mars base, as we'll see, which is going to be very significant, which was their transshipment base. So this huge deluge and the nearing of Nibiru at this time reinstated the crisis where they needed Enki and his crew to go back and do gold again.
So they became pretty codependent with humanity. They really needed us. And we needed them because they quickened us, and we now have a far more advanced civilization than we would have had we just progressed naturally.
And, you know, every time there's a significant nearing, right now Nibiru is in Sagittarius and won't be around for many a year, but when Nibiru again comes, it may well blow away their atmosphere, and they might want gold again. But we are not going to be mine slaves. We are not going
again.
To pick up the shovels. We are willing to perhaps assist them in mining, but we want their secrets of longevity. We want their secrets of good health. We want their non-polluting technology, because they know how to capacitate.
They have transportation systems now, and that don't require flinging ourselves around the planet in boxes that are fueled by fossil fuels. So they have technologies which will clean up our atmosphere, clean up our waters, clean up the soil, give us extremely long lives. And we're developing these things as well. It's just that our government doesn't let us have it.
Yeah, as we know from Michael Tellinger's work in the south of Africa, they had these great big lanes, 8 to 12 feet wide, lined with several feet of and millions of pounds of granite, highly magnetic granite boulders that are arranged in the form of a capacitor, which was along the ley lines of the earth and generated electricity, basically very powerful electricity, and they also could move loads because they used the white powder of monoatomic gold. So they were moving things around, building huge stuff, and they were not. They did not have to use burn oil, and they collected these this energy, and they in pyramids, which they put all over the world. They were like their power stations. They used hydrated hydrochloric acid and zinc combined to create hydrogen, which they then sent up into a toroid pattern through the top of the pyramid, and it was enhanced and magnifying the vibrations of the earth that are going on all the time, and they picked them up in towers all over the world. So they had an electric grid that they can move things with, that they could communicate with, that they communicate all the way back to the home planet. But we're getting a little ahead of our story. Next time we will talk about how the Anunnaki, the Nibirans, decided to make the world while they reclaimed it, and there was a long period of cooperation and peace. It's like the Satya Yuga that we're now entering. A period of peace came next, and we will talk about it in our next show. Janet, do you have any other words?
Well, that's all for today. I just wanted to thank everybody for joining us, and please do check out our websites. We have EnkiSpeaks.com, EnkiSpeaks.com, AquarianRadio.com. On Enki Speaks, on the very first page, is a link to please buy our book, which is Anunnaki Gods No More. And it's right there in the top right-hand side. You can see a picture of the book, and it's available on Amazon.com. So we've enjoyed presenting this show to you. We thank you for joining us, and do come back again soon. And with aloha, love, and blessings, aloha.
Shalom.
From Maui, Hawaii.
Thanks for joining us today on Aquarian Radio. We broadcast daily and our schedules on AquarianRadio.com. Listen live by calling 646-649-0893, or you can listen live by calling 646-649-0893, or listen to our archives on AquarianRadio.com. Join us again soon, and do tell your friends, the age of Aquarius and the paradigm of peace is now.
Aloha, this is Enki. You know me as Aquarius, and this is our age, the Satya Yuga. Time to celebrate with us. We have programs on all chakra tantra, love styles and relationship choices, counseling strategies and techniques that you can use at home. We have extraterrestrial radio, where we deal with alienology, paranormal people, and we have an experiencers network. We have a section called Ancient Aliens, and the programs therein are Enki Speaks, Nimma, the Mother of Humanity, has her program, and we revise ancient anthropology. And most important of all, we have peace paradigms, because this is the age of peace, harmony and understanding, sympathy and love abound. No more falsehoods or derisions, mystic crystal dreams and visions.
And this has been another episode here at AquarianRadio.com.
AquarianRadio.com.